Good afternoon, WordCamp NYC. We have our final talk for today in the Winter Garden lecture. We have Marty Spellerberg and Zack Rothauser. Marty, raise your hand. Which one's Marty? Which one's Zack? Here we go. This is Marty, and this is Zack. Hooray! And so you know a little bit about them. Marty offers interactive design, development, and communications consulting to artists and museums. He's also the director of Spellerberg Projects, a cultural incubator and contemporary art gallery in Lockhart, Texas. Marty has 20 years' experience in interactive design, including a decade working specifically with museums. Zack is a senior WordPress developer at WP Engine. He has worked in web development for the past 6 years, having spent time at several large agencies freelancing, and now working for the marketing team at WP Engine. Hi, everybody. Please join me in giving a warm round of applause and welcome to Marty and Zack for their talk, Merging Physical and Digital Experience, Creating Museum Experience with WordPress, REST API, and React.
We're going to walk you through the design process and some of the technology decisions that went into building this video kiosk for the Clyfford Still Museum. Along the way, we'll show you how WordPress can be used in for some non-traditional projects that aren't exactly websites, and build a kind of a unique project here.
Thanks for the introduction. Marty. And I also want to shout out a couple members of our team who aren't here today. There was Renata Groff from a design studio in Chicago called Normal. So a lot of what you're going to see is came out of her shop. And our colleague at the Clyfford Still Museum is Sarah Wombold. She's heads up digital. So this is the Clyfford Still Museum. In Denver. It's located right downtown in the large district, and it's adjacent to the Denver Art Museum. This is the man himself, Clyfford Still. He is among the first generation of abstract expressionist artists, and is considered to be one of the most important painters of the 20th century. Clyfford Still, he worked in New York, but midway through his career, he stopped showing his work, and he held on to it. He didn't stop working, but he stopped showing. And when he died, his will stipulated that his collection of work and his archives could go to any U.S. city that would build a museum dedicated to his work. Quite a shrewd character. It worked, and Denver took his estate up on the offer and built a museum for him. The Clyfford Still Museum opened in 2011. Their collection represents about 95% of his entire output, and about 3,000 works created between 1920 and 1980. It was a purpose-built building designed by Allied Works. So this is the interior of the space where the digital project would live. The biggest challenge in the design of the piece was to figure out how to call attention to a screen presence in a subtle way. How do you make people notice it, be interested in it, and want to walk over to it? The designers at Normal created a lot of digital and video prototypes before sharing with the development team, looking to incorporate the design into the space. Once we have museum goers interested in a kiosk, the challenge is to create an experience that provides discovery while having an underlying logic to the design. We achieved this by making the interface minimal, keeping it simple and unobtrusive. This allowed the content to be the main guiding force. So this is what we're going to cover today. I'm going to talk to you through the design process. Then Zack will do content management, the kiosk API, front end. Then I'll take over caching and mention the hardware. So the design. To start the project, we looked at archetypes of video presentations. I'll show you three of the strategies that we discovered. This one clearly is the Netflix model, so it's a main landing page with a recommended video. This would be categories, clusters of videos, representing different categories. And then this would be sort of more of a sort of random discovery experience. I'll show you three of the design approaches that were considered. This one was called Browse, where the main landing page was in a single video. You could navigate through the different videos in that subject, left and right, swiping left and right, and you could move to different video topics by going up and down. So it was a very spatial representation. There would be a menu up in the corner that would give you the list of the categories. And there would be an index. This is a text-based index, and this ended up making it all the way through to the final build kiosk, relatively unchanged. We also looked at a thumbnail view of the same information, but it didn't make it any further. So this is design iteration number two. This was called Immersive, and it's centered on a full-screen video that was playing constantly. You could pull up the navigation and information about the video at the bottom, and then navigate the different clips and different sections in here. This would pull up the navigation to move you between video topics. And then this was the third design iteration that was the one that we actually took further, and concept here was slideshow. So you could either tap on the main video, or tap in the main area to watch the video, or you could tap the band to navigate to the different topics. Once you're in the video, you would use the icons up in the corner to navigate between videos and different topics. This is the design that evolved to the final kiosk. The vertical got changed to a horizontal structure, and the horizontal structure became this screen here. So it would be a sort of an attract screen that as you were walking through the museum, the video would play. The large category titles would display with a video that would play in the background, so that would represent the experience. When you tap on one of the category names, you get the thumbnail, the description of the category. Tapping up in the corner will take you back to the home, or tapping back to the index screen. When you tap a video thumbnail, full screen video takes over. Tapping the video will pause it and bring up navigation to the back or forward. And that's the kiosk, and we have it out in the lobby. You can see it afterwards. But this is a WordPress conference, so we wanted to talk about why we chose WordPress for this. One of the central reasons was that WordPress was already in use by the museum, the content management system of the museum website. So staff of the museum were already familiar with WordPress, comfortable in WordPress, and also comfortable maintaining a WordPress site. The staff at the museum would use WordPress to add new videos. They're constantly shooting new videos so they can manage the content of the kiosk. without developing.
And kind of adding on to that, WordPress was a good solution here because there are a lot of things we didn't want to build from scratch. Like it's a relatively simple application, so WordPress already had user roles, things like that. I had a REST API built into it, which we would end up using. But there was a lot that we didn't need from WordPress. We ended up kind of simplifying the admin interface quite a bit. So you'll notice like the pages and posts that you're used to expect in WordPress, they don't really use those because they just weren't used for this project. And instead we have videos that are the two kind of main things that people need to be able to edit. So the first bit of content that they have, they can put in videos. So these all link to video. They're actually managing the video files, uploading them to Vimeo, putting captions up there. And then this syncs with the Vimeo API, so we wrote an integration that pulls in data like the thumbnail, the duration of the video, all the closed captioning information, and then link to the actual MP4 file from Vimeo. And we're doing this on the admin side in WordPress, so when they have a new video to add to the collection, they'll paste in the URL, click the refresh button, and that hits the Vimeo API and pulls in the relevant data. This saves a bit of money on the Vimeo plan. They only need to hit the API occasionally instead of constantly using the API. Once they have the videos in place, interface for editing the set categories that we don't want each screen. They have a drag and drop interface here where they can choose the videos and organize those. And there can be multiple sets. Usually the kiosk is set to one set of different kiosks around the building can have a different set of content. So the next step after that was to create the for the kiosk. The built-in API to WordPress, the REST API, got us a lot of the way there to what we needed. So we needed to add on a little bit for that, to add the data for videos and sets so that those would be showing, and some additional settings for the kiosk that would get sent out. So this is really kind of pointing to being more like a web app and not a what you normally think of as a WordPress site. So this is not the front end is not powered by PHP at all. It's just generating the REST API content in the front end here. So we, on a normal website, you have things like the screen flashing as it reloads to another page. Really an acceptable experience here. We needed something completely custom that would feel really like a native app on your phone or on a desktop computer. And a lot of the components on here were completely custom, not things that you would find in a WordPress theme. Things like the video player components and some of the menus. This is all built on top of the REST API. If anyone wants to play with the JSON response, the API tools will be there to check it out. So the actual front end of this was built in the app. I kind of went into that how a normal website didn't work for this. So we actually basis for being able to build a like native-like experience with smooth transitions between screens so that really custom components are how many people in here are familiar with the app or what it does? I really like working with React because of the component interface and how wide of support there is in the developer community right now. And we really need to get to this project. If you want to check out the source code for the question for kiosk, there's a link there to GitHub where I have the source for the React side of it. There are a few different libraries I use on top of the app that kind of handle the animations. And that ended up being maybe half the development time was getting like these animations and transitions to be really smooth and getting the video player just right. We did not use Vimeo's actual like embeddable video player at all, so we needed to match the rest of the interface. These all ended up being custom React components that were built for this project. Give it back over to Marty.
So, in order for this tool, this interface to be accessible to people who are hard of hearing or deaf, to visit the museum, captioning was a priority for project. You know, closed captioning is a pretty normal thing to do. Videos closed captioning is achieved through a file called a subrip text file. When you're working in video or in Vimeo, add the caption file to the video, and there are captioning services that will create the caption file for you. Over the course of this project, we discovered a trick for doing that. If you upload your video to YouTube, they will generate a caption file for you, so then you can download that caption file, edit it, and then upload it to Vimeo. So, you know, or you can use other sources and employ. And I'll just touch on the hardware that we ended up using. We ended up with these Dell 22-inch touchscreen monitors, and we did the classic museum trick of hooking them up to a Mac Mini. Not going to have a Mac Mini, but they hide in walls. And so we used Macs for it in order to have the Mac power a touchscreen device, a driver. There's a guy, he makes a driver for it. He seems to be the guy who makes the driver for it. And it's the it's touchbase.com. It's called the Universal Printer Device Driver. Yeah, it's in the morning. To get the kiosk out in the hall working. So just wanted to touch on that. We did look into other solutions. We looked into a Windows-based solution that would have worked on Google Acer 6, and there's also a Unix distribution that could work on the 6, so that might be a solution going forward. But this year we used Mac. And those are slides. So, thanks. And I would say, we have a working version of the kiosk on the WP Engine table, so if you'd like to try it out.
We'll have it all day tomorrow, so if you want to come by and try it. I guess it's open to questions. Do we have a microphone for questions?
That was not a requirement from them. Yeah. Good question. The requirements that they put for us was for the hardware. The question was about did we support Braille, a blind visitor to the museum? And the answer is unfortunately in this iteration, no, but it's.
sounds like there was a lot of data that you were dealing with. Did you come up against any performance issues?
The question is around performance issues of the content in our data. We chose to host the videos online with Vimeo. We did look at hosting them like locally on a server inside the museum. It was determined that the Wi-Fi would support the download of the videos. So
this is in some ways easier than the regular website because we knew like this thing was going to be installed in the gallery. It would pretty much only exist there and be reliable internet connection. So yeah, in a lot of ways it's easier to try to optimize the app for the connection.
One thing to say about the REST app, it hits WordPress initially, and it downloads all the information, and then it runs with that information for the rest of the time. So when you first load up the application, usually in the morning, the computer restarts in the morning, it downloads all the information, and then it runs all day.
You kind of touched on it just then. Is this a website in a browser? Is it an Electron app? Or what's actually running on you?
Right, yeah.
It's just in the browser. It's a full screen site. There's a Chrome extension. It's from kiosk. That kind of locks down Chrome so that people can navigate it.
And is there any tips that you could give on dealing with the touch and animation with React? That's something I've struggled with getting to look professional.
Yeah, that was a lot of the time spent on this. The touch specifically, that was a little bit different on this screen than building for touch on an iPad. There's some different JavaScript events that just thing fired that are different than the iPad ones. So you kind of have to handle those and fix it up there when it's on an iPad. As far as handling touch events, didn't do anything with just basic one computer touch. That was a little bit easier. Handling animations. Forget the name of the library that I used, but I used one of the CSS animation ones. Did most of it in CSS.
Follow up to that briefly. You mentioned that once you load the data, this is running completely in the browser. Is that initial page load coming from WordPress from PHP, or is it a standalone HTML page?
Standalone HTML page.
And sort of to ask more about the REST API, are there any changes or any frustrations that you had while working with the REST API or with the rest of WordPress that you would think could be changed or improved in order to better support this type of project?
Everything works pretty smoothly to me, especially with the embed parameter on the REST API. I think I have a link to the videos that I wanted to pull in along with the set. I just have one request. I don't think I have really any frustrations with the REST API.
So when you were going through your different design iterations, was it mainly for respect to the artist or like the intuitive kind of user experience, or what was your kind of thought process there?
There were certain things in the museum one to achieve from a educational point of view, so a lot of our feedback was coming from them, and I think it was to try to get to the most straightforward way of presenting the information, how to get people to the videos, surfacing the amount of content that was available, showing the breadth of it, and making that the path to that as straightforward as possible. The design visual language was really influenced by the physical design of the museum to try to fit within that space, and the physical design of the museum was directly influenced by the artwork itself. It was area to see our work. So I think that was sort of the path, right? From the artwork to the space, from the space to the business.
Thank you.
How did you guys find WP Engine and end up working on this project? Like, how did you think WordPress, right? Like, how did you get there? Because there's so many different products that are offered, and like to museums and experiential. So, like, how did you end up there?
Just to be clear, it wasn't the WP Engine.
You guys
project.
Are. Okay.
I work at WP Engine, but this is a thing that I started before I started working.
Okay. So, I mean, how did you end up with WordPress? That's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
like, how'd you make that decision? Like,
yeah.
Because there's so many off-the-shelf solutions that are trying to offer this kind of thing. So, like, what made, how did you come to WordPress? I mean, if you're a WordPress developer, right? But, like, how did you decide to seek out a WordPress developer?
Well, we made the choice early on that it was going to be, like, a web-based. Museum wanted the ability to update it without, you know, visiting each kiosk and having software installed on each machine. So they wanted it to be a web application. And then React surfaced as the framework in which to build the front end. And WordPress was implemented on the management system. It's used on a few other microsites, like the main website and then a bunch of microsites. So if they were already used to working with WordPress, and they already used to, like, maintaining WordPress installations, it fit within their stack, and they didn't want to, you know, go too far out. React was, it was the first time React was used by the museum, so that was an addition. But, yeah, those two pieces, and it was the museum's familiarity with it, before, for the main website, for the traditional website. We invite you to come take a look at the kiosk at the WP table. Thank you very much.